Good morning, and Ken's just called the bells to finally cease their chiming on this Remembrance Day service. And a very warm welcome to everyone, a special welcome if you're joining us through the video link or perhaps catching up during the week. Special welcome to any visitors, and we're delighted that so many could join us this morning. Who perhaps are visiting family and friends, or just perhaps taking a trip in the area. We're delighted that you can join us for this slightly more formal service. As we've been doing for the last 102 years, we'll remember those who've given the ultimate sacrifice and those who continue to serve servicemen and women around the world in humanitarian and peacekeeping operations. And I'd like to call Leslie, our church warden, out just to give us an update on the Ukrainian appeal this Christmas.
Just to keep it short, we've had some fantastic donations already for the shoeboxes. I don't know if some of you weren't in last week. We had a visit from people who run a charity called Puma, Plymouth Ukrainian Medical Aid. And they're doing a shoebox appeal. We've only got a short while to do it because they're going out in a couple of weeks' time. So we're trying to get lots of shoeboxes together, put together for the children of Ukraine who are having, who've basically got nothing. We've had a fantastic amount of stuff given already this morning to put in the shoeboxes. We've got a list that we can give out of stuff if people want to make up their own shoeboxes or give us stuff, or give us donations to buy stuff. And we can, Pat, who is, where are you, Pat? Pat's there, she's got a clipboard with all the information on. So at the end of the service, if any of you would like to come back, let us know if you have any questions. We can give you a list of stuff you can put in. And I think that's about it, really. Thank you very much.
Leslie.
Thanks, Leslie.
Boxes.
Oh yes, I've got. Well done. And you won't forget. There are we have got a load of boxes coming that need wrapping, but at the back there's half a dozen boxes. I'd be very grateful if anyone would take maybe just one box home and wrap them in Christmas paper, because it is quite a tedious job to do a load at a time. So if anyone would be willing just to take an odd box home and bring it back next week, that would be fantastic. Thank you.
Thank you. And a reminder that we're delighted always with the children who join us, so don't feel that whatever they'd like to do would interfere with the service in any way. But we do have a creche area at the back if you'd like to make use of that. And Tom and the leaders of the youth program will be taking the children out partway through the service. But we'll start with a sentence of scripture. I lift my eyes to the hills. From whence will my help come? My help comes from the Lord, who made heaven and earth. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. We meet in the presence of God. We commit ourselves to work in penitence and faith for reconciliation between the nations, that all people may together live in freedom, justice and peace. We pray for all who in bereavement, disability and pain continue to suffer the consequences of fighting and terror. We remember with thanksgiving and sorrow those whose lives in world wars and conflicts past and present have been given and taken away. And we'll stand to sing our opening hymn, "I Vow to Thee, My Country." Jesus says, "Repent, for the kingdom of God is close at hand." So let us turn away from our sin and turn to Christ, confessing our sins in penitence and faith. And we sit on the altar for our confession. We say together the words on the screen. Most merciful God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, we confess that we have sinned in thought, word, and deed. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have loved our neighbours as ourselves. In your mercy, forgive what we have been. Help us to amend what we are and direct what we shall be, that we may do justly, love mercy, and walk humbly with you, our God. Amen. And an assurance of forgiveness. Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon us. Pardon and deliver us from all of our sins. Confirm and strengthen us in all goodness, and keep us in life eternal. Through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
And the young people will leave us at this stage, and we'll just pray for them now. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the privilege of working with your young people and to lead them in a knowledge of you and to bless them with the presence of Jesus in their lives. And we just pray now for all of the leaders as they lead a program this morning. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. And we'll stand to sing again, "How Deep the Father's Love for Us." our reading. The reading this morning is from Micah, chapter 4, verses 1 to 4. In the last days, the mountain of the Lord's temple will be established as the highest of the mountains. It will be exalted above the hills, and peoples will stream to it. Many nations will come and say, "Come, let us go up to the mountain of the Lord, to the temple of the God of Jacob. He will teach us his ways, so that we may walk in his paths." The law will go out from Zion, the word of the Lord from Jerusalem. He will judge between many peoples and will settle disputes for strong nations far and wide. They will beat their swords into plowshares and their spears into pruning hooks. Nation will not take up sword against nation, nor will they train for war any more. Everyone will sit under their own vine and under their own fig tree, and no one will make them afraid, for the Lord Almighty has spoken. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
That moment you dread when the preacher hasn't turned up has arrived. We've been a bit quick. I thought I'd give him lots of time, and let's continue with the next hymn, and we'll give him a moment to take a breath. So we'll stand to sing "Abide with Me." Oh, right, hang on. Andy, you're most very welcome.
This morning, folks. For those I've not met, my name's Andy Bowden. I'm the vicar here, and it's good to have you with us as we spend time, quite rightly, considering this important day that is Remembrance Sunday. Thank you to whoever read, by the way, as well. As we begin, let's pray. Heavenly Father, we look around and see so much division and fighting in our world, we can so easily despair. But help us to remember that you are the same yesterday, today, and forever. Thank you that all of history is in your hands. Thank you that you are trustworthy, that you are faithful, and that you are good. Help us to rest assured in your compassion and your love this day, and encourage us with a vision of your future, where war will one day end. Amen.
Amen.
Well, today, like Remembrance Day itself a couple of days ago, it is difficult for lots of different people and for lots of different reasons, I might suggest. Whatever the rights and wrongs of past wars and present conflicts, it's important we think of those who so selflessly gave everything for the peace that we certainly enjoy in this country today. Some have died, some survive. Some survive but carry terrible injuries and scars. Not just physical, but mental. We remember with great sadness those who have died. And we think in the present of those who serve in our armed forces today in various parts of the world. And our annual 2-minute silence really seems the smallest of sacrifices that we could make in remembrance and honour of them. But can I pose a question? What do we think of in those 2 minutes silence? What comes to mind? Or when we hear stories and people recount their own experiences of war, what do we think about? How do we feel? Private Harry Patch was an ordinary soldier in the First World War, and he recounted a particular event that he came across in 1917. He said, "At Pilkem Ridge, I can still see the bewilderment and fear on the men's faces when the order came to go over the top. I came across a Cornishman ripped from shoulder to waist with a shrapnel injury. As I got to him, he said, 'Shoot me.' He was beyond all human aid. Before we could even draw a revolver, he had died. His last word, 'Mother.' I will never forget it," said Private Harry Patch. And in some ways, I wonder if that is the point of our silence. We too must not forget it. We must not forget the heroic actions of so many men and women over the years, but we should also acknowledge and never forget the human evil that leads to war and to conflict. Remembrance Sunday, quite rightly, is a time to look back. It's a time to gauge our presence, but Micah the prophet forces us to look forward. I don't know about you, but I hate a spoiler, whether it's a film I'm desperate to go and see and someone who's seen it the day before tells me how it ends. Disaster. Some of you might or might not know that today England played Pakistan in the cricket T20 World Cup final. Actually, you can't get signal here, so no one's going to know the result anyway. But I'm looking forward to watching the highlights. I'm staying away from radio, staying away from the internet and the TV news so as not to have a spoiler that gives me the result. And this morning in Micah chapter 4, we have a bit of a spoiler. Micah tells us what God is going to do in the future. But rather than turning away and not wanting to know, actually, we should focus our eyes on what Micah has to say. We should open our ears to listen. And we should think with our minds about this incredible reality that God will bring about. You see, Micah sees God at work in the moment, figuratively speaking, where he will establish his holy mountain. Now, mountains might not mean an awful lot to us today, other than those who like to go out and about and climb the things. But for the ancient world, mountains were really, really important, incredibly significant. It was the place where the heavens met the earth. Therefore, it was the place to be closest to God, and so shrines and temples would be set up on top of mountains. But notice about God's mountain in Micah's vision. It is established as the highest of all the mountains. And it's the place not just for one group of people, but where many peoples will come together. What will happen at this mountain? Well, Micah tells us. It is the place where God's word will go out. It is the place where God's judgment will be seen. It is the place where disputes will be settled once and for all. It's the place where God will rule and God will reign. It is the place where there will be perfect peace. See, this is the time, this is the place where there will be no more conflict. We were told that nations will beat their swords into plowshares, their spears into pruning hooks. Nation will not take up sword against nation, nor will they train for war anymore. Do you see, there will be a time where the surging tides of human conflict will end. There will be a time where we can know peace and security, but notice it's not through the debates and discussions at the United Nations. It's not through the skills of those who might organize and negotiate around government and world leaders' tables. It's not at the intervention of a mighty military force. It's not when there's a mass uprising of people. Now don't mishear me, it's important that as individuals and as people together, we stand up against what is wrong. But let's not be fooled. We cannot collectively solve the world's problems. We cannot. Any other person or ideology saying that they can fix the world's problems is a falsehood. Yes, one day peace will reign. Yes, one day war will end. Yes, one day the universe will be refashioned and transformed, but only by the power of God and Him alone. Then there will be no more pain, no more broken lives, no more wounded pride, no more wars, no more bombs, no more missiles, no more refugees, no more asylum seekers, no more ethnic cleansing, no more slaughter. Nation will not take up sword against nation, nor will they train for war anymore. Similarly to Micah chapter 4, in the last book of the Bible, in Revelation, we get a wonderful picture as the Apostle John sees the reality of the future for all who trust in God. Revelation chapter 21 verse 4 says this, God will wipe every tear from their eyes. Death shall be no more. Neither shall there be mourning, nor crying, nor pain anymore. For the former things have passed away. Just ponder those words again. God will wipe every tear from their eyes. It's a beautiful picture, isn't it? It's a picture of intimacy between a parent and a child. Like a father holding his son or daughter who he loves so very, very dearly and gently wiping away those tears. It's all right. It's done. Never again. It's over. It's a beautiful picture, but we might be left asking, well, how is this possible? What can bring an end to war? Well, it's a good question, but can I say it's not quite the right question. It's not what, but who. See, God will bring an end to war and destruction in our world through a person. Through the Messiah, through the King who will be called the Prince of Peace. Jesus was the one who said, greater love has no one than this, than they lay down one's life for one's friends. And can I say, Jesus was far more than just noble words or sentiment. He was the one who didn't simply live out these words, but actually went further. Bringing peace between us and God. As Romans chapter 5 says, God demonstrates his own love for this. While we were still sinners, Christ died for us. The future that Micah looks forward to was made possible through Jesus. For God loved the world so much that he gave his only Son, that whoever believes in him will not perish, but have eternal life. Today is a somber day as we look back and remember the death of a loved one or as we share in the sadness of a friend. Today is a day we should pause and give thanks for those who are seeking peace in our world today. But can I encourage us also to see today as a chance to look forward to that day when nation will not take up sword against nation, to that day where they will not train for war anymore, to that day of perfect peace brought about by God himself. Through his Son, the Prince of Peace, who offers that peace to all who will come to him. Amen.
And as the time approaches 11 o'clock, we make our act of remembrance. They shall not grow old. They shall grow not old as we that are left grow old. Age shall not weary them, nor the years come down. At the going down of the sun and in the morning, we will remember them. We will remember them. When you go home, tell them of us and say, for your tomorrow, we gave our today. And we'll remain standing to sing our next hymn, Abide With Me.
Thank you.
And in a week with encouraging news about the withdrawal of Russian forces in Kherson and the lasting ceasefire allowing humanitarian aid to go into Ethiopia amongst the people of Tigray, we pray the Church of England's prayer for today, the act of remembrance. Let us pray for all who suffer as a result of conflict and ask that God may give us peace. For the service men and women who have died in the violence of war, each one remembered by and known to God. And our response is, give God peace. May God give peace. We say together, God give peace. For those who love them in death as in life, offering the distress of our grief and the sadness of our loss, may God give peace. God give peace. For all members of the armed forces who are in danger this day, remembering family, friends, and all who pray for their safe return, may God give peace.
God give peace.
For civilian women, children, and men whose lives are disfigured by war or terror, calling to mind in penitence the anger and hatreds of humanity, may God give peace.
God give peace.
For peacemakers and peacekeepers who seek to keep this world secure and free, may God give peace.
God give peace.
For all who bear the burden and privilege of leadership, political, military, and religious, asking for gifts of wisdom and resolve in the search for reconciliation and peace, may God give peace.
God give peace.
O God of truth and justice, we hold before you those whose memory we cherish and those whose names we will never know. Help us to lift our eyes above the torment of this broken world and grant us the grace to pray for those who wish us harm. As we honour the past, may we put our faith in your future, for you are the source of life and hope, now and forever.
Amen.
And in a moment's quiet, we just pray for those known to us who are in any form of distress or illness. We pray for those at this time of financial difficulty and uncertainty. We pray for the poor. We'll close our prayers by saying together the Lord's Prayer. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. And we now stand to sing our next hymn, In Christ Alone.
Christ alone, I am best loved. He is the light, my strength. okay.
We're obviously running a little bit faster than everybody thinks. At this stage, Bob was going to put a bit of a human face on some of those who served locally, and we'll probably catch up with that right at the end of the service. And we'll sing together the national anthem while we... delighted to pray with anyone who would value prayer for themselves or for someone close to them, and the prayer team will be available just on your right by the Drake Chapel if you'd like to take up that opportunity. And we'll conclude with this prayer of blessing. God grant to the living grace, the departed rest, the King, the Church, the King, the Commonwealth, and all the world, peace and concord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be amongst us and remain with us always. Amen.